Today is the 8th of December 1998. This is the interview with the survivor Anita Lasker-Wallfisch, maiden name Lasker. The interviewer is Joanna Bachen. The interview is taking place in London, in England, and the language of this interview will be English. My name is Joanna Bachen, J-O-A-N-N-A-B-U-C-H-A-N. I'm interviewing the survivor Anita Lasker-Wallfisch, A-N-I-T-A-L-A-S-K-E-R-W-A-L-L-F-I-S-C-H. The interview is taking place in London, in England, on December the 8th, 1988, and the language of this interview will be English. To redate this interview with the survivor Anita Lasker-Wallfisch, it's taking place on the 8th of December, 1998. First of all, could you say your name for me, please?
Anita Lasker-Wallfisch.
And could you spell that for me?
A-N-I-T-A-L-A-S-K-E-R-W-A-L-L-F-I-S-C-H.
And what was your date of birth?
17th of July, 1925.
And where were you born?
In Breslau.
And at the time, where was Breslau?
Breslau was in Germany, the east of Germany.
And could you tell me your father's name?
Alphonse Lasker.
And your mother's?
Edith Lasker. And her maiden Hamburger. Name?
Did you have brothers and sisters?
Two sisters.
And could you tell me their names?
Marianne and Renate.
And were they older than you or younger?
Older, yes. I'm the youngest.
You're the youngest. Just talk about childhood in Breslau before the war, before the Nazis came.
It was a totally normal childhood. You know, I come from a family, typical Jewish, assimilated. I didn't even know I was Jewish. And it didn't seem to be a problem to be Jewish. You know, I mean, it was total mixture. My parents went to the synagogue twice a year, to the high holidays, that's all I remember. I don't think I've ever been in a synagogue that I can remember, maybe once or twice. But the Jewishness didn't play any role whatsoever. We were, I think, quite well off, sort of typical middle class. I remember very nice flats we lived in. We had, at one time, I remember, two maids, and then one maid, and then no maid, as time went on. But I have very good memories of my childhood.
What did your father do for a living? What
was his profession? He was a lawyer. He was a lawyer, and I think he was a very good lawyer. And, you know, I have very good memories of my childhood. I mean, everything was totally normal and nice.
And what about your mother? Did she stay at home with the children?
Yes, my mother was a musician actually, but in those days musicians didn't really work in the sense that nowadays you go out to work. Yes, my mother stayed at home, but she played the violin. I mean, she always practiced, and she played in the local orchestra, which was in the end was a Jewish orchestra. And there was a great deal of chamber music in our house. I mean, there was always music.
Did you all play together as a family?
Yes, we all had music lessons. My elder sister learned the piano, my second sister learned the violin, and I played the cello, and we had a trio together, the three children, and there was always, every week there was a chamber music evening in our house or in other people's houses. The music was absolutely part of the setup.
You said that Jewishness wasn't particularly important in the family. The big holidays, things like Hanukkah or They wouldn't necessarily be celebrated, would they?
No, I remember Christmas, for instance. We certainly had a Christmas tree. And maybe we lit Hanukkah. Yeah, perhaps we also lit Hanukkah candles. Maybe. I don't remember too much about that. But I do remember my grandmother from my mother's side, my mother's mother. We used to go to the Seder evening, which is the Jewish Easter, as it were, celebrating the liberation of the Jews from Egypt. And I also have very good memories, partly because I always got some chocolate, I remember. And we liked that. And there was sort of special food, you know, various things to remind you of this and the other thing that happened. So there was a bit of that.
As you were growing older, were your friends Jewish friends or German?
Well, you see, we were sort of marginalized very slowly. I suppose when I was very little, there was no question of Jewish or not Jewish, and we went to a private school, which was very, very small classes. It didn't come into question who is Jewish and who isn't Jewish. But I do remember that my first anti-Semitic remarks I heard in that particular school. So that must have been after 33, so I must have been about 8 or 9, when a child said, I was just about to wipe the blackboard, and the child said to another child, "Don't give the Jew the sponge." I thought, well, this is very strange. And then people started spitting at you in the street and calling you a dirty Jew. And I remember asking my father what all this was about, and he tried to explain. It didn't really make too much sense. I was full of envy of people who didn't have that stigma. You know, I thought, for a child, this is most peculiar, especially if you're not brought up in the Jewish tradition, and everything is, you know, people are people. That's how we were brought up. And obviously, then we had to leave the normal schools, and eventually we had to go to a Jewish school. So I think quite naturally, the friends were Jewish friends.
Were you ever given the sense, though, that you wouldn't have been welcome in a German house, say?
Possibly, but I think one avoided to expose yourself to that situation. I don't remember ever having gone to a German house and be told, no, you can't come in. I don't remember that. But maybe naturally, you see, I'm thinking back of something now that happened in my childhood, and obviously I can't remember everything, but I don't remember a feeling that, oh, I can't go into that person's house, they won't let me in. I don't remember that.
Was there much conversation at home between your parents? What was going on? What should happen to the family?
Yes, I picked that up eventually. One picked up, as a child, one picked up things, you know. I think in those days parents were always careful not to say too many things in front of the children. But there was a definite sense of something was not right here. And I remember, I think in 33, you know, there was a sort of general depression, depressing atmosphere in the house, which I didn't quite understand why, but yes, I do remember. But my father, you see, was what was called in Germany a Frontkämpfer. In other words, he took part in the First World War, he was fighting at the front, he had the Iron Cross first class, and that type of Jew, totally assimilated in Germany, thought that they would be protected. And I remember my father saying also, you know, the Germans can't be that stupid. This has got to stop soon. The Germans can't be that stupid. But the Germans were that stupid. And I think at the very beginning, people who fought at the front also had some sort of dispensation. I can't tell you exactly what sort of, but it seemed to be a good thing to have been fighting at the front. But that didn't last too long. And my father was then, once even we started talking about emigration, and you know, so easily said, why didn't you all leave in time? With a profession like my father's and 3 children, it's very difficult to even think of emigration. How are you going to earn a living? Had he known at the time what was happening, of course he would have gone somewhere. But it wasn't that easy to go somewhere, because frontiers closed. Frontiers closed, and also the Germans made enormous difficulties about immigration. It wasn't that easy to just pack your bag and go. You had to pay Vermögenssteuer and, you know, all these, and then you had to get special dispensation that everything was all right, Unbedenklichkeitserklärung. You had to make an inventory of everything you own, which I still have and is in my book now. Every table, every tablecloth and what it costs. It was enormous undertaking to emigrate.
And the special tax, the Steuer that you mentioned, that had to be paid before you could leave?
Exactly. So in other words, if you wanted to go, you had to pay. It wasn't as easy as people imagine, okay, I will emigrate.
With all this going on around you, was it possible for you to be a normal little girl?
Yes, in a funny sort of way, life seemed to go on fairly normally, but, you know, our idea of what is normal was totally distorted, slowly. I mean, I will say I've got letters that I wrote to my sister, and I'm amazed what I'm writing still in 1940, you know, when the war was already declared. And in Germany, there wasn't the sort of... they didn't establish real ghettos in the sense like that happened in Poland. Only we had to leave... Everything was rather slow. We had to leave the flat that we lived in and had to move somewhere else, to my aunt, for example, into a very small flat, and we were very crowded there. But it wasn't just Jews living in that area, if you see what I mean. Everything retracted slowly in one's life, you know. Everything, you were marginalized and you weren't allowed to go, you know, the Juden Unerwünscht appeared everywhere to sit on a park bench. You weren't allowed to go to the cinema. I remember being very upset I couldn't go to a swimming pool, you know. I mean, that affected me personally. Jews were not wanted and pushed into a corner, slowly and surely.
Had you decided what you wanted to do when you grew up?
Yes, I never had any doubt I was going to be a cellist.
Had you started training seriously?
Not seriously. I mean, as a child, we all learned instruments, you know, but I was the only one that was really... that was very devoted to that. I was going to be a musician, and that was that. And there was no question about anything else, ever.
Were your parents happy with that?
Yeah, very happy. Yes, and I had all the help I could get, you know, teachers. But then came, of course, a situation that the Jewish cello teachers or cellists had emigrated, and we couldn't find a teacher anymore for me because no German teacher would be so brave as to teach a Jewish child.
Were you always at home in Breslau with the rest of the family?
No, because of the situation of not finding a cello teacher, I was sent to Berlin. Because in Berlin, everything, you know, being a very big city, things were easier, and there were still Jewish musicians there, and I was sent to have cello lessons with a very fine cellist who was there at the time. So I was not at home, 1938, so I was 12, 13. I was sent to Berlin.
What was it like for you living away?
Lovely. Yeah, I felt extremely grown up, you know. I mean, I was on my own in Berlin. I must say I do admire my parents. You wouldn't do that now, I think, at that age. But I was still, had to go to school, so special permission had to be granted for me to leave school and have school subjects in privately with a private tutor. So I had a room in the house of the lady who was supposed to teach me school subjects. And I felt terribly grown up, you know. And I thought it was tremendous to be in Berlin.
Who was your teacher in Berlin?
Leo Rostal, very, very fine cellist. And his brother, in fact, lived in England. He came to England after the war. And he taught practically everybody who was anybody. Everybody went to Max Rostal. Leo Rostal was his brother, also a very fine cellist. And I mean, I have to thank him a lot because he gave me a very good grounding. It only lasted 6 months before the whole thing. Then came Kristallnacht. But I'm very, very grateful that he gave me at least in that time some grounding, although I didn't practice too much, I must say.
What happened at Kristallnacht?
Well, I was in Berlin at Kristallnacht. And I, of course, during the night I didn't know what was going on, but in the morning one knew. And I went out to have a look at the streets, and it was an incredible sight, really. All the shops smashed up, and I have a very strong recollection of smelling alcohol. It was running down the gutter, you know, they smashed up liquor shops. And phone calls from my mother, I should come home immediately, because that was the beginning of the end, actually. So, and then my teacher emigrated anyway. He went to America, and I went home.
What sort of circumstance was waiting for you when you got home?
Well, I don't know what we were thinking at that time. I mean, then I think that was the time when my father probably started making very serious attempts at emigration. My father was a great Anglophile. He wanted to go to England. And England was not exactly an easy place to emigrate into. And England or America. And I think talk about immigration then started seriously. And what it was a sort of waiting period. That's right. One was waiting for something to happen. And I got a bit bored because I had no longer cello lessons. I didn't go to school. And I then the war broke out, and that was the one was trapped. And I decided to go back to school then, just to do something. The school was still functioning for a bit anyway.
Was it a Jewish school?
So by that time it was a Jewish school, and I had lost almost 2 years of schooling with this, going to Berlin and waiting around. And I was so determined to go back into my own class that I actually caught up in 4 weeks. I caught up with 2 years of schooling. So I really went bananas, trying to catch up. And I went back to school, but that didn't last very long. Then the schools closed.
Were you still all together, your two sisters and your
parents?
No,
my eldest sister just went. She went to England. For some reason, I can't quite remember why, she went via England. She was supposed to go to Palestine. She was a great Zionist. And she was in England for a bit, I think, in order to go on, and then the war broke out, so she remained in England during the war. So we were just the two of us, two sisters, and my mother and my father.
Where had your sister's interest in Zionism come from?
Well, we all eventually joined the Jewish youth movement. I don't know where it came from with her. Anyhow, she was a great Zionist, and she was going to build up the country, a pioneering spirit, and she wanted to learn. In those days, the normal thing was to finish school and to do your A-levels and go to university. Now, my sister wanted to become a bricklayer and a shoemaker, and my father was horrified at this. She eventually became a carpenter because she was very gifted. She was a carpenter. And she worked in a carpentry factory, I don't know what you call it, a workshop in Breslau. And I think that was raided on the 9th of November by Nazi youth. And so my sister, who was 18, I suppose, by then, just said, I'm going. So she went.
Would you have gone with her?
No. No, I mean, we were still really very young, and there was no question of that. And, as what, you couldn't have just go. You couldn't just go. I have this correspondence at home, applications asking, can my daughters come, and refusals. You have no idea how difficult it was to actually emigrate.
How aware were you of the situation that perhaps not yourselves were in, but Jews in Germany were facing?
Well, one couldn't at that time possibly imagine where it ends. I don't know, it's difficult to say. I think we knew things were bad, but how bad, nobody could really perceive at that time. And my father was a great optimist, I think in our family, one was always thinking somehow we will get somewhere. And for some curious reason, which I'll never understand till the day, my father still thought he could go to Italy. Italy was the last thing. Even during the war, I have letters where we are writing to my sister, by that time clandestinely via Switzerland, and because there was no postal service, that we are going, we probably, our next address will be Bolzano. He must have had some contacts in Italy. And had one gone to Italy, which of course didn't happen in the end, the Italians, of course, they were with the Germans, but I think it was more possible perhaps to survive in Italy. Although what we would have done there, I can't think, but I know that this is what happened. And we even went to I remember that certain things stick in my mind, went to the Italian embassy with our papers, whatever we had, to get the visa to go. And I remember the man with his stamp in his hand nearly bringing it down to the paper and then hesitating for some reason. There was something that still had to be cleared. And I remember this terrible, terrible disappointment again. Well, we're stuck. And we were stuck.
What were you doing at this time? The Jewish school had closed down. There was no schooling for you.
What happened is then we started getting called up for war service. Yes, my sister was called up to work on a, what do you call it, a rubbish tip. That's right, rubbish tip. It was unbelievable. She had to sort out dead rats from toothpaste. You know, one saved everything. Toothpaste in those days was still in metal tubes. So the metal had to be sorted from this, that, and the other, and it was the middle of winter, and she got very ill. So she was transferred to a paper factory, and eventually I was also called up to work in a paper factory.
Do you remember where you were when war broke out?
I remember where I was when war broke out, and I also remember looking out of the window, thinking like a child, now everybody is shooting everybody else, but, you know, it was quiet. War had broken out, but it was silent, and I thought, that's a funny war. That's not how I imagined war. Oh, I remember that very well, yes. Because that really was, you know, one knew one was trapped.
How old were you then?
In 39, I was 14.
What sort of reaction was there from other people, Jewish or non-Jewish, to the fact that war had broken out?
I couldn't really tell you exactly, but I suppose everybody was very shocked. No, it was a sort of, we knew that the curtain is coming down now.
What sort of war service labor did you have to do?
Well, I was working in the paper factory making toilet paper.
And what sort of hours did you have to work there?
Yeah, that wasn't terribly pleasant. 6 to 2 was the first shift and 2 to 10 was the second shift. And in order to get to the factory, which was outside Breslau, we had to get up at 4 o'clock and get into a train. It was in Sachau, which is outside. Strangely enough, when I went back there some time ago, I was taken to that factory and I couldn't recognize anything, nor did I remember how far we had to walk from the station to the factory. Certain things, you know, one blocks out because it was very cold and, you know, can you imagine getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning? Anyway, that's what happened. So we worked in these two shifts.
Were you made to wear a yellow star?
Yes, oh yes, by that time we wore a yellow star and we weren't allowed to sit down in the tram. And, you know, I mean, we were totally sort of pushed out.
What about shopping, buying food, things like that?
Oh, well, that was very complicated because then, I mean, when the war broke out, food coupons were introduced and the Jews had a J on their coupons and only certain shopping hours were allowed. So it was very, very difficult. And you got smaller rations. I don't remember exactly, but only certain shops, you know, and certain times. And yeah, it was that's how it was.
While you were doing this work, were you able to stay in the same apartment with your family?
No, but I can't remember. Yes, I think we had already had to leave our apartment and lived in the apartment of my aunt. There was my aunt, my uncle, and a very ancient couple. And then us, I mean, it was, you know, we were a lot of people in a very small flat, but we somehow made the most of it. I mean, I've got these letters, you know, where my mother writes to my eldest sister that Renate and I are sharing a tiny little room and we sit there in the evening and sing canons. And we always tried to keep cheerful somehow. I don't know how we managed it, but we tried.
How long was that sort of life able to go on for?
I'm not too sure about dates, but in that particular period, we did work in the paper factory, and during that period, my aunt and uncle were deported. Then it really started, you know, that you were sent ostensibly to the East to work, which one liked to believe. And then my parents were deported. And then this old couple were deported. And in the end, my sister and I were alone in this apartment. And it was very difficult altogether because as soon as my parents went, we had to look after these old people who didn't understand that, you know, food was difficult to get. Nor did we ever have we were never at home when we were allowed to go shopping. It was a ludicrous sort of catch-22 situation. And so my sister just took the Yellow Star off and, you know, tried to get food because she didn't look Jewish, which was supposed to, you know, people look Jewish or not Jewish, she could get away with it. And yes, it was a very difficult time, and these old people never understood why there wasn't enough food, you know. We were working in the factory. It was quite crazy, really. In the end, we were on our own, and yeah.
What happened when your parents were deported?
You mean how were they deported? Well, they were given 24 hours notice, which was not altogether usual. Sometimes people were just given 2 hours notice or had to go straight away. They were given 24 hour notice to report at a certain place. So, you know, we wanted to go with them, but my father, I think, knew quite well what was going on by then, although he didn't let on. And obviously we wanted to go. Let's just, family has to stick together. And my father said that he will ask permission. And I suspect, and he went out of the house and he came back half an hour later and he said, no, you're not allowed to come. I suspect that he never ever went and asked permission. He went around the block a couple of times. And he said the very wise words, where we are going, you get there soon enough. And that was that. And he was right. So I have the greatest admiration for my father, looking back, because what it must have cost him to do that.
How did your mother react?
She cried. She was very frightened. You know, one, by that time one had heard what was going on in the East, but I mean, although one tried not, thought it's not possible. But there was always a lurking suspicion, you know, if you hear a rumor that many times, that there's something in that. So we were alone then, my sister and I, and but you know, if I look back, we just sort of went on regardlessly. One, you know, you didn't give yourself time to really think of anything. You just carried on. We go to the factory and this is that, and we do this, that and that. And in the end, of course, we couldn't maintain the flat or anything like that. And then we had to go into an orphanage. There was still a bit of Jewish community there. And we were given, what do you call it, a form on that, I can't think, a guardian. We were given a guardian because we were way underage, and put into this orphanage, which we were horrified at the idea, but in fact we quite enjoyed it. We weren't there for very long, but it was the first time that we got food put in front of us without having all the problems of getting it and cooking it or whatever. Yeah.
And we've just come to the end of the first tape there.
Okay.
Mrs. Anita Lasker-Wallfisch. We were talking there about your sister and yourself being in an orphanage in Breslau. Who ran that orphanage?
There was still a sort of skeleton of Jewish community there. But we didn't stay very long because I will just tell you the story, because we were working in this paper factory. We were brought up speaking French at home. And in this factory, there were Jews, Poles, and French prisoners of war. And we were both rather bolshy youngsters. I suppose it must have been very difficult to control. We started making contact with the French prisoners of war, which was, of course, strictly forbidden, which made it extremely attractive for us. And we were approached for whether we could help somehow by procuring civilian clothes, I mean, to help these prisoners escape. Because there was a scheme at the time, there were French civilian workers and French prisoners of war in Germany. The civilian workers were people who were picked up after the war, civilian young men who were brought into Germany to work. And as a French civilian worker, you were allowed to go home from time to time on holiday. So the idea was to produce papers for French civilian workers and give them to the prisoners. So they didn't even have the problem of the language. With the false papers, they were then people, etc. So they needed civilian clothes, and they needed the Gothic script, which we could write to fill in the paper. So we became forgers, in other words. We started forging passes with a German script and procured civilian clothes and altogether, you know, did what we were asked to do. And all this happened through quite a funny story, a bit like Midsummer Night's Dream, because in the Jewish lavatory, we had segregated lavatories, Jews, Poles, and Germans. There was also some German sort of people who were in charge, what you call it, foremen, yeah. And in that Jewish lavatory, you could, there was a hole in the wall if you pulled out the mechanism where you pull the chain. And on the other side of that wall was a refectory for the French prisoners. So that was our post box. You see, we put messages through, we talked through it, etc., etc. And a lot of prisoners escaped. And, you know, we thought that we are being terribly clever and nobody noticed that we are doing this. But we were being observed, and people were very cross with us because everybody gets endangered. These Lasker girls do these terrible things. And one day the hole was blocked up, so we knew that we'd been observed. So we decided in our total naivety to try and escape ourselves. I mean, we were talking about the middle of the war. And we produced papers for ourselves. I mean, we had contact with various people. We never knew too much who they were. I think that was on purpose, that in case we get caught. But we were told it's time that you go yourself, and so papers were produced for us, and we were workers in an upholstery factory. If I think back now, I didn't even know whether there were French women civilian workers. But you know, at that time, anything was good enough to try and get out. So I became Madeleine de Montaigne and worked in an upholstery factory. And the fact that we were in an orphanage sort of was an impediment to our escape plan, because they, of course, mustn't know what we are doing, and the train didn't leave till the evening. So we left the orphanage as though we were going to work. But we spent the day with friends of ours who were a mixed marriage couple. The husband was Aryan and the wife was Jewish. And the train was supposed to leave in the evening, and then really a terrible thing happened. I mean, they were much older than us, you know. And I think looking back, everybody knew that we were doing something crazy. But we felt better to do something than just sit and wait. So they wanted to accompany us to the station, which we asked them, please don't, but they insisted and came to the station, and there was the train to Paris, and we were arrested there at the station. My sister, strangely enough, was already in the train. We had, I think, four suitcases or whatever, three suitcases. She was in the carriage when the Gestapo came. And I thought, if the train leaves now, she might just get away. But she came out to look for me, and we were all arrested, including our friends. And that ended very badly, because eventually we had a... Well, I'll try and tell you chronologically what happened. We were then taken to the station police, right? And there we remained French. We remained French because we didn't quite know why we were being arrested. We remained French. We thought we'll try that out. And at the station police, we waited for a car to take us to the Gestapo headquarters. By that time, a friend of mine had supplied us with poison, which was quite a normal thing in those days. It's crazy to think, with cyankali. I forget what it's called in English.
Cyanide.
Cyanide, yeah. So we had cyanide upon us, and I had it in my stocking, a little bit of cyanide, because a little bit is quite enough. And as I sat there with my sister, we thought, well, maybe this is the moment to take it, because after all, now everything is going to go, you know, everything is lost. So I managed to divide this under the, we were sitting by a table, to take it out of my stocking, divide it, give her a bit, and I kept a bit, and then we waited for a moment to take it. And then it transpired that the car that was supposed to fetch us did not arrive, so it was decided we would walk from the station to the Gestapo headquarters, which was very close. So we were a whole group of people, blackout, dogs, walking along the street. And we thought, now we're going to do it. And I said to my sister, we will count to three and then we'll do it. So we counted, one, two, three. And I even showed to my grandson now the very corner where we did it. And we licked the stuff, and I thought I was going to die, because that's what you're supposed to do when you're licking this poison. But I didn't die at all. You think you're going to die, so you feel a bit faint. Rubbish. It was sweet. The stuff was sweet, and we kept walking. Well, what this friend of mine, who's still alive, I've just saw him a couple of weeks ago, what he did, he gave us this stuff at some time, and I opened it in a little bottle. I opened it and I took a whiff of it, and it smells of bitter almond. It's bitter almond. And I closed it again, and that was that. And then he said to me, this man, I thank him my life, really, you're not ready to go yet. Give it back to me till you're ready to go. The day before you go, I'll give it back to you. And he gave me back the very same bottle. Of course, I didn't test it again, but he changed it into sugar. So really, he's the guy. I have to keep telling him, you know, thank you very much. So we did not commit suicide. And we were quite glad, actually. We didn't really, it didn't feel right somehow, and it just shows you, you never know when the end has come. And we were taken to the prison, and we even insisted to have an interpreter. When we think back, we were very cheeky, because we couldn't speak a word of German, you see. So we were put into prison as French girls.
In the paper factory where you'd been working, mm-hmm. were you approached by the French who asked you to take part in this forging?
It wasn't even in the factory. Somebody came to our house. I don't remember exactly how it was, but we were being recruited, really, and we were very glad to do it. I mean, I always found it totally unacceptable to just sit around and wait to be killed, you know, just because I happened to be born as a Jew. It gave you the feeling of doing something. I suppose it's like, you know, like belonging to the, you know, to the people who fight against what's going on. What do you call it in English? I can't think now. Widerstandskämpfer.
Resistance.
Resistance. You felt you're doing something. Not just sit there and wait till they come for you, and then by that time we already heard about gas chambers. So that we'll do something. If they come to kill me, they kill me for something that I've done, not just because I happen to be born a Jew, which I have no choice about. So,
were you afraid ever then?
Yeah, a lot of people always ask me, were we afraid? You know, you get so used to being afraid. I think we were afraid all the time. We got so used to being frightened all the time that you didn't even notice it anymore. Fear was the accepted feeling. And, you know, you knew they were after you, and what can you do? You just hope for the best, you know. I know it sounds crazy and very difficult to believe, but we weren't really frightened all the time. Or we were so used to it, we didn't really notice it.
How long were you held by the Gestapo?
Well, then comes a very curious situation. You see, we were then put into prison. But by that time, it was very late at night, and we were still speaking French, and all these prison guards were digging out their school French. And we were put in a cell together, the two of us. I think they did so many stupid things, if I look back. They put us in a cell together, and we were then thinking, what shall we do now? And then lots of days passed, and we were not called to the Gestapo. By that time, we had time to discuss how we're going to handle this thing. Well, the first thing, it became pretty obvious we can't keep up this French business for too long, because Breslau is not a huge town. The fact that two Jewish girls have tried to escape was absolutely the news of the day. And it's like attending your own funeral. People who came into the prison cell afterwards told me that a priest actually prayed for us, a German priest in a church for these two Jewish girls, which was quite a brave thing to do. So it was well known that these two Jewish girls have escaped or tried to escape. So we decided to come clean because the farce, it was getting farcical being French. So we asked to see the governess of the prison to make our big confession. And she was an extremely nice lady, I must say, in retrospect. She took it extremely well and just noted the fact that we are now simple Anita, Sarah, Lasker, and not Madeleine de Montaigne. But the trouble started when we were taken back to the cell, and all the people who tried to speak French with us suddenly knew what fools they've made of themselves. So it was slightly unpleasant, the whole situation, but we were then who we actually were. And then we waited and waited and waited to be called to the Gestapo. That was pretty nasty. But by that time, we'd made a plan, what we'll say. You see, if they had separated us, it would have been much worse. So we decided that I will be the, because I'm the younger one, I'll be the one that knows nothing. And my sister will be the one who did everything. So when there's any question, because, you know, if you're lying is quite difficult, but two people lying simultaneously is impossible. So I was the stupid one who did everything that my elder sister told me, etc. And it was almost 3 weeks before we were called for the first Gestapo interview. And that, again, is a rather typical affair. We were called to this interview, and our suitcases were lined up, and we had to sign for the suitcases. And there was a suitcase missing. And that was a very important thing for the Gestapo, that the suitcase was missing, and we had to sign what was in the suitcase. And we already by that time thought this was absolutely stupid. Who cares about a suitcase in this situation? The tale goes on that almost a year later, I was called down, and was called nach unten gerufen, to identify a suitcase, and my suitcase had been left in the train, you know, when my sister was trying to put the suitcase in the rack and came out and was arrested. The suitcase was left in the train. So a suitcase, unlabeled, unlocked during the war, traveled to Paris or wherever it traveled, back again, was located by the Gestapo and restored to the rightful owner. This simultaneous, when they were stealing, killing, murdering, confiscating, no, the suitcase has to be restored. I'll come back to that story later when I'm in prison, because it's not the end of the suitcase story, which is so ridiculous. But that's somehow typical typical German. Ordnung muss sein. Suitcase. It's your suitcase, you know. I never saw these things again. Anyway, there was a system there. The great thing was to get out of the clutches of the Gestapo. And since we had actually committed a crime, we had made a criminal offense, forgery, helping the enemy, attempted escape. These were our indictments when we finally got called in front of the court. I think there was a fight behind the scenes between the legal system and the Gestapo, who did not see entirely eye to eye always. And my father was a well-known lawyer, and we suspect that somebody in the legal profession said, no, we will give them a court case, because that was a very good thing, to be actually stuck in prison was very preferable to being sent straight to Auschwitz or any other concentration camp. And we already knew that. So it was obvious after 21, it takes 21 days before the decision is made. And since it took 21 days to be called back to the Gestapo, we knew that we will have a court case, which was a great relief. But the people who did not get a court case, like my friends, this mixed marriage couple, they were sent straight to Auschwitz. So we were the lucky ones compared to them.
What happened when the Gestapo finally came to interrogate you?
Well, first they took my sister. Again, they were extremely stupid. First they took my sister, and then she came back to the cell and told me exactly what's been going on. So I knew. It was not what you usually imagine a Gestapo interview is. I mean, we were not beaten, we were not tortured, because I think they already knew that we were going to go to the court. I can't remember too much really about it, because I think I just kept saying that I don't know, and I don't know anything, and asked my sister, who already knew, they had already asked. They were, of course, interested to know who else is implicated in this forgery business, you see, because it was quite a big organization. In fact, the Eric Williams, you know, the man with the wooden horse story, he used one of these papers. I found this out years after the war. This was quite a paper, false paper factory that we were implicated in.
How much did you know about, though, when you were doing your bit of it?
Did
you
know? I didn't know anything about that. No, I didn't know anything about that. I only found that out by pure chance, because I went to the Imperial War Museum, because I happened to be working nearby, and there was an exhibition of Eric Williams' paraphernalia, you know, the wooden horse and all that stuff, and the paper he used on the wall, and I suddenly had this feeling of déjà vu. And then I saw a stamp, Breslau. And I have, in fact, I wrote to him, and we have a little exchange of letters about that.
He was a British soldier who escaped from a Stalag prisoner of war camp.
That's right, with a fantastic story with the wooden horse.
With your false papers.
Yeah.
Was there what you would think of as a normal legal process? Now, here you are, you're a criminal. You're also Jewish, but you're a criminal in
Yes,
German
there
eyes.
Was a sort of legal process. The only thing is that it was called the Sondergericht. Well, Sondergericht means special court, and it was a special court. What wasn't normal is that we had no defense. Not sure that we weren't offered a defense. I don't think so. No, I mean, we just stood there, but we already knew that it would be a good thing to have a heavy sentence, because we thought the longer the sentence, the longer we can stay in prison and not go to a concentration camp, because by that time one knew what was going on. So we weren't really interested in defending ourselves. Anyhow, it was plain to see what we did. I mean, we forged papers. The ridiculousness of the indictment is Feindesbeihilfe, you know, helping the enemy. Well, the enemy wasn't our enemy, as it happens. And attempted escape also seems a rather curious indictment if you try to escape from certain death. You know, it's not exactly criminal offense, but we were quite happy to have a criminal offense, and we were sentenced to 3.5 years, etc., etc. My sister was sentenced to penitentiary, and I got 1.5 years to stay in prison still, and we were quite happy with this, strange as it may sound. And my friends did not get sentenced. They were, they let go, and the Gestapo already waited outside. And none of them survived, except for the German, my German friend, Werner Krumme, who became a very important prisoner in Auschwitz, important in the sense that because he was German, after all, he had a very responsible position in the camp, and he really did most fantastic things to help other people. And he's got a tree in Yad Vashem, which tells you enough. I mean, he was an extraordinary man.
At this point, though, you and your sister had been together ever since the war had broken out. Were you able to stay together now?
Well, we stayed together till we were had our court case. I mean, we were already in prison for a year. It took a long time before we came to the court. And then she was sent to penitentiary, and then she was sent away. So then we separated. She had to go to Yawa penitentiary, and I stayed in prison. And by that time, we said goodbye, and we didn't think we'd see each other again. I mean, you know, the situation then was so, I don't know, fluid is not the right word. And so she left, and I stayed in prison, and still hoping to sit there till my sentence is finished. But by that time, we already heard rumors that they, you know, tried to make room for other prisoners in the prisons, and the Jews. Because the moment you've had your court case, you were not so safe anymore, you know, as we thought we might be. And sure enough, I was sent, I think the court case was in June, and in December I was sent to Auschwitz, not having finished my sentence.
How were you treated in prison before you were deported?
Well, you know, looking back, a prison was a very cushy place. I mean, it's not as cushy as now prisons. If I think all the prisoners complain about this and the other, it's laughable. We all sat in one cell, very small cell, four people, one bed, mattresses, so at night, you know, you filled it with anything. And we worked in prison. We were given a job to do, which was, thank God, you know, and I painted toy soldiers. I met my first Scottish soldier in prison, you know, with skirts on. I thought, what is this? Yes, I mean, they were made of plastic, of course. I mean, not like the original, which in a way, you know, it's very, very meticulous work, this painting a toy soldier. They come there absolutely just brown, and then you have to make the face, and then you have the eyes and eyebrows and the uniform. We were told what colors to use. And you can do it well and you can do it badly. And, you know, if you do it well, it makes the time pass. And there's a sort of satisfaction in turning out nice-looking soldiers. I mean, it sounds crazy. But the important thing about the soldiers is that the girl who brought these soldiers to the cell was not a prison guard. She was obviously employed by the toy soldier factory or something. And she used to breathe in and breathe out, and soldiers here and color this, that, and the other. And when my sister had gone, she started talking to me and asked me where my sister was. And a really very nice and remarkable relationship developed there. She was obviously a very nice young girl. I would very much like to meet her again now. She must be over 80, but she was, as far as I'm concerned, she was tremendous support.
What was her name?
Fräulein Neubert. She was very small, and we used to call her Püppchen, you know, little doll. And she used to open the cell door and say, what do you need? And then she used to shut it, and then we started talking very softly in case another guard hears it. And she was very interested in everything, and she used to bring, I found at the bottom of the soldiers, some bread or a piece of cake or something, which her mother had sent us. You know, very touching. To us, this was a terribly important thing. You know, nobody was nice to us. She was terrific. And how were we treated? You know, prisons are, I mean, you know, you sit in that cell, which I was trying to describe. I went back into that cell. I did a documentary for the BBC. And I went back, I think I must be the only person in the whole world who goes back to the prison where she was a prisoner in. And I took my daughter with me, and I remember it was cell 116, but they've been renumbered, and I said, it doesn't matter, one cell is like the other. And the cell door was open, and my daughter nearly fainted, and I said, look, this is luxury now. They had a television set in there, they had beds in there, and they had a toilet in there, a flushing toilet. We had what's called a Kübel, a pot where four people were shitting into it, and it was emptied once a day. So I needn't tell you what it was like in such a cell. And we were allowed out once a day for half an hour to walk in the circles in the yard, hands on the backs, not a word spoken, you know. That was prison life then, but I believe you me, luxury compared to what followed.
How was it that you were told, you were called and told you're being taken out of the prison? Who told you that?
Well, by that time, although one isn't allowed to talk to anybody, everybody knows everything in prison. I will also tell you that some of the prison guards were decent, some were not decent, you know, the usual thing. rumors went about that Jews will have to go, and you also knew where you were going on which day. If you called on a Monday, you knew that was transport. Oh, Tuesday, Thursday, Auschwitz. I was called on a Thursday. So I knew where I was going. One just knew. Don't ask me how things penetrated.
But how much did the name Auschwitz mean
to
you?
By that time, it meant exactly what it actually was. Because one, you know, the gas chamber bit had really got repeated to such a degree that, but you know, human nature is most peculiar. You knew where you were going, but you're still hoping, maybe not. Maybe it's, you know, as long as you breathe, you hope. So Auschwitz was not exactly good news to be called on a Thursday. But again, you know, I mean, although I had this crazy life, there was some degree of tremendous luck all the time accompanying me. Because if you were actually a convicted prisoner, you did not travel to Auschwitz in a cattle truck like we know now. Cattle trucks arrive from all over Europe and people spill out and there's a selection on the ramp. We came in a prison train, you know, with cells, you locked in a cell, and no selection. Convicted criminals had more chance of survival than innocent citizens. No selection, and I think the reason behind this, that since we had been involved in court cases, it's possible we might be called back, you know. I think that probably was the reason behind it, but I didn't realize that. I didn't know that much about Auschwitz, that I was already lucky to actually go straight into the camp.
How many days were there before you were taken? You were told on the Thursday. When did you actually leave Brussels?
Oh, the next day. Oh, could have even, yeah, the next day. I was then put into another cell. You know, that was the end of me with all the stuff. You go to the cell before you get sent away. And that girl who brought us the soldiers came to visit me in that cell, which was already quite dangerous. She had no business anymore. She was my soldier supplier. And brought me, and I will never forget that, again, something to eat from her mother, and a whole lot of proverbs. Germans are very sentimental. You know, they have both sides to them. Proverbs, and wishing me good luck. You know, it was, to me, that was something fantastic. There was some human expression there. And, yes, and the next day off we went. But, you know, Auschwitz isn't very far from Breslau, so we must have left in the evening because I arrived in Auschwitz. It was black, it was dark. So I don't know exactly what time we left.
And we've just come to the end of the
Okay, so I'm going to have a...
with Anita Lasker-Wallfisch. You talked earlier about being lucky the way you arrived at Auschwitz. What do you remember of seeing it for the first time?
Well, there were two lucky aspects. One of them is that my arrival in Auschwitz was deferred because I was in prison, because every day less in Auschwitz was a day gained. And then that arrived with a transport of convicted criminals who did not have to go through a selection at the ramp where, you know, they stood and said to the right, to the left. But I didn't realize that till I was actually in the camp. I mean, the finer points of the camp I only really learned once I was in it. And
What sort of reception was waiting for your training when you arrived?
I remember we arrived late at night, so we were put in a barrack to wait for next morning. And I've often been asked, well, what was it like to arrive in Auschwitz? All I can remember is that it was freezing cold. It was December in Poland. And an enormous amount of noise, screaming, dogs barking, and people in capes, black capes, walking about. I mean, not the most welcoming atmosphere. And we didn't know at all now what's the next thing going to be. And the next thing, in fact, was the next morning. We were taken to another barrack and had to take our clothes off and had a number tattooed on the left forearm, and your head was shaved. That was the next thing. And then again, a tremendously lucky thing happened. I didn't realize who was doing this, shaving of heads and tattooing. These were, in fact, prisoners who had this job. And they were always very curious to hear, they thought you're coming from the outside. What are the news? How's the war going? You were always hoping the war would end.
What and date was this that you'd arrived?
December 43. December 43. Apropos, when I was hoping for the war ending, I'll just go back to my prison days now, that we did hear that the Allied had landed in Sicily. And we thought this was fantastic. So that must have been early 43, I suppose, the Allies had landed. And I was so happy because I thought, and now they are here. And it'll take them a week, 2-3 weeks, and they'll reach the prison and open the gates, And I was, one of the people in my cell's job was to sew buttons on cartons. I don't know whether you can still buy buttons. So her job was to sew these buttons on cartons. So she had a huge bag of buttons there. And I was so happy about what was happening, I took this and I threw it up in the air with sheer joy. I thought, everything will be okay. And when I started picking up the buttons, it took a lot longer than throwing them in the air. I thought, well, maybe it'll take longer. After all, well, it did take much longer. But this is just apropos, one was always thinking in terms the war might end and just in time before they get us. So this girl who was processing me asked me, how's the war going and where do you come from and what did you do before the war? And like a fool, I said, I used to play the cello, and I thought it was a crazy thing to say in Auschwitz. What importance can that have in Auschwitz? And then the extraordinary thing happened. She said, oh, that's fantastic. You stand here. And all the others went. I don't know where. I stood there by myself. Everybody had left. And I saw showers overhead, and I knew gas chamber showers, and I thought, oh dear, that's it. But not a bit of it. She came back with a lady who turned out to be Alma Rosé, and again, I didn't understand anything because she was quite well dressed. She wore a camel hair coat and she had a headscarf. And she started asking me questions about cello playing. I mean, it was so ludicrous, the situation. Where did I study and who was my teacher? And fantastic, we need a cello because we have an orchestra here and we haven't got any bass instruments. And don't worry, she said, you will have to go to quarantine, but they will get you out and you'll soon be in the music block. I thought, well, this is crazy. And this is exactly what happened. Also, I will mention that the girl who took my clothes off me, she said, give me your shoes because I think I could use them and they'll take them away anyway. Anyhow, I gave her my shoes. And these shoes have quite a story attached to them because they were pigskin shoes when I was given them, bought them by my mother. And I spilled ink or something on them and I got into terrible trouble with my mother because I ruined the shoes and what can we do? So we dyed the shoes black and they looked very sad. So we bought some red laces with great big pom-poms in it. And in these shoes, I was arrested, and with these shoes, I arrived in Auschwitz. And it was through these shoes that I met my sister again, because she arrived a couple of weeks after me in Auschwitz from the penitentiary. Same girl, She saw the shoes. I'm not sure that she was wearing them, but she saw them standing. She recognized the shoes. You see, these were unique shoes. This wasn't Marks and Spencer, you know. And she said, where did you get these shoes from? I said, well, somebody came in here a couple of weeks ago and is in the orchestra. And I said, that's my sister. So she came running. By that time, I was in the orchestral block. She came running and said, I think your sister has arrived. So, I mean, what can I tell you? Pair of shoes. Spoiled pair of shoes. Because we could easily have missed each other. Anyway, this is just an interjection. So she, yes, and I had to go to the quarantine block, which is beyond description, because that's, you've probably seen in pictures, on shelves. We were all lying on shelves. And it was terrible. I mean, it was for most people the last port of call, really. This was dreadful. And but sure enough, after a few days, an SS man came in and called, well, where's the cellist, you know? So suddenly I was the cellist. And I was taken to the music block. And
well, tell me about the music block. Was it separate from everything else?
No, it was just one of the blocks. One of the blocks was the music block, number 12. And there I saw this bunch of people there, you know, with most peculiar instruments. I mean, it wasn't, you mustn't think in terms of a proper orchestra. I mean, there were people, mandolins and guitars and a few violins and couple of accordions, that sort of thing. Now there was a cello, I mean, a bass, you know, that's exactly what they've been waiting for.
There was a cello for you?
There was a cello there. People have often asked me, where did it come from? So strangely enough, it never occurred to me to wonder when I was there, but looking back, it probably came from somebody who had a cello under his arm when he was taken to the East, soi-disant, to work, you know. I mean, people come with instruments. You know, somebody comes to your house and says, I'll give you 2 hours, or give even 24 hours. You take what you think is the most precious thing to you personally. And that could have been somebody's cello. So there was a cello there. So she asked me to play something, and I mean, I hadn't played the cello for about 2 years, so I asked for a little bit of time to, you know, see whether I could still know where the notes are. And I played something to her, slow movement of the Boccherini concerto. I tried to play it, but there was no danger of my not passing the audition. I mean, she needed a cello, however badly I played. So I became the cellist of the orchestra, which I think is the reason why I have survived.
Who was Alma Rose?
Alma Rose was a very remarkable lady, and in retrospect, we all agree, because we are still, who is still alive, we are still in touch, we all agree that we have to thank her our lives. She was the daughter of Arnold Rose, and Arnold Rose was a leader of the Vienna Philharmonic, had a very famous string quartet, the Rose Quartet, and she was the niece of Gustav Mahler. I mean, a tremendous musical tradition there behind. She herself was a very, very fine violinist. And but the most important thing, she was a very, very strong personality. She commanded respect from us anyway. I mean, we were scared stiff of her. But even from the SS. She was never, I mean, she was dignity in person, personified. She was dignity personified. Very strict, I mean, she was terribly strict with us, tremendous discipline, you know, wrong notes. We were, most of us kids who had learned an instrument when they were little, so we were hardly orchestral material. She had to literally, note by note, you know, but her standard had to be well played. And a terrible book has been written about the orchestra by one of the orchestral members, who painted Alma in a way as though she was afraid if we don't play well, we will be put in the gas chamber. That was never the case. She wanted us to play well because she had these standards herself. And also somehow it distracted us from what was going on around us in a way. I mean, all these things I analyzed in retrospect. You know, we were so afraid not to come up to Alma's demands that we temporarily forgotten, and you know, you just look out of the window and you see the smoke. So She kept us together really with an iron discipline. That was Alma Rosé. She didn't survive, but we all really, I think we owe her a lot of gratitude.
Why was there an orchestra in Auschwitz?
Well, you know, there wasn't just an orchestra in Auschwitz, there was an orchestra practically in every camp. You may well ask why. We had a job to do. We played marches for the, you know, there were all these factories surrounding Auschwitz and other concentration camps for slave labor. And the Germans, you know, like things neat and tidy, and they play marches, so we go left, right, these columns of people who go out to work and come back from work. Less people coming back than went out, usually. That was our job number one, to play the marches, morning and evening. And we were extremely privileged, because I know that, really, I found that out afterwards. If you compare it with the men's orchestra, for instance, in Birkenau, they had to go out to work during the day. We didn't. We went back to the block, and we rehearsed music for the various occasions that they wanted to hear music. Like, for instance, we had to be always prepared for some Germans to come in and ask for something. We played light music, you know, it wasn't very serious music.
What sort of things?
Selections from operettas. Then there were quite a few singers there, sort of arias from Butterfly and whoever was, Peter Kreuder was the in thing, Zara Leander, you know, these, I suppose, pop songs of the time. I know Alma played Zigeunerweisen. I mean, there was an occasional...
Zigeunerweisen, they're the gypsy.
Yeah, by Sarasate, it's you know, very famous virtuoso violin thing. We had something called Dvořákiana, was some sort of Dvořák melee. But you know, there were big problems, because where was the music for such an orchestra? So there were people who were engaged to just write out notes, because we say we'd get a piano reduction and had to be orchestrated then for the instruments that were there. So quite a few people were employed in this slightly safer situation than going out to work.
How many people in all, would you say?
About 40, I would say, roughly.
How many of you played, actually, in the
orchestra? Well, I suppose Notenschreiberin, as they were, probably there were six. So, about 40 people played, and perhaps five people or six people wrote, I can't remember exactly. Wrote out the music. Yes.
What sort of typical day was it for you then? What time did it start for the orchestra?
Well, it started very early. We didn't have watches, so I don't really know what time it was, but very early out, you know, get up and take, a few of us had to take the chairs and the music stands out, plant them where we play, and then came back to the block, and I think then we got something to drink, something lukewarm, and went out to play. I can't remember exactly in what. No, I think we got the drink we got after we'd done our marches. I think that's how it was. Yes, some people had to take out the music stands, etc., and come back, and then we would all march out and play, and then we go back to the block. And then we were counted, you know, Zählappell, and then we started to learn our pieces.
How were you regarded by the other prisoners in Auschwitz?
You know, opinions are varied. I have never really come across any abuse, but obviously we were envied. Obviously we were envied by people. But on the other hand, we could also help people. They used to call us die Damen vom Orchester. You know, we were the ladies. We were better dressed. You know, we were the showpiece, a bit like Theresienstadt, not quite as pronounced. But, you know, when people came to the camp to have a look, what is it like in Auschwitz, they would come to us. Here's music, you know.
How were you regarded by the Germans, by the guards?
Well, luckily, the two people in charge, I mean, two women, Drexler and Mandel, were very interested in the orchestra. That was their thing, the orchestra. So they didn't, I don't know how they regarded us, they probably still thought that we were, mind you, we were not, you can't say just dirty Jews, because we were the one of the few blocks which were mixed. We were not just Jews in the block. There were also non-Jews there, you know, Poles, Russians. I don't know how they regarded us. We were just the sort of the ornament, you know, of the camp.
How did you feel about being in that situation?
I knew that I was very lucky to be in that situation. Much to be preferred to be in any other situation. I mean, there were sought after occupations in the camp. One is to be a musician, the other is to be an interpreter, or to be a runner like my sister was, to messenger. Or to work in the kitchen for obvious reasons, you know.
When you look back on it, how aware were you? You say Alma Rosé was such a figure, was dominating and demanding of you, but how aware were you of the life around you?
Oh, we were very aware of the life around us. I mean, I was asked at an interview once, how did you know there were gas chambers in Auschwitz? Well, the gas chamber was about as far away from me as... I mean, it was there. You could see it. You could see it. You could see the smoke. You could hear it. You could see the people walking past into the gas chamber, you know, the Lagerstrasse. Yeah. I mean, in 1944, when the Hungarians came, you saw that endless stream of people walking in and coming out in smoke. I mean, you couldn't not know it. You know, it was there. We lived there. And it was a matter of time when we are going to go in there. I mean, that was the thing. Are we still alive today? Well, tomorrow we may be smoking, you know, in smoke. So when we were, you know, when it all came to an end, first of all, Alma died, which was also almost a demise of the orchestra, because it was impossible to... We carried on, but in a very, you know... That was missing, that discipline was missing. It was a bit of free-for-all now, and also, obviously, the war was going badly, the Russians advanced, the interest also of the Germans was, you know, diminishing. And eventually, we were called out of the block, and separated Jews from non-Jews. So we thought, well, that's it. That must be it. But it wasn't it. We just had to relinquish our clothes yet again. You know, it's always give up what you... Because by that time we'd organized a number of, you know, acceptable garments. And we were put in a cattle truck.
What date was this?
That was end of November. I don't remember the exact date. Some people do remember, I think 26th of November, I don't know exactly. Again, cold. Cold,
this
very
is 1944
cold. 44, yes. And what had happened outside is that the Russians were advancing and the Germans tried to obliterate their traces and send the prisoners westwards. But we had no idea where we were going, and also I was very worried about my sister who wasn't there, and I'm going somewhere. So somehow I managed to get a message to her that, you know, we are going on a transport, and she appeared and just joined us. Because we couldn't, at that time, we don't separate again, you know, so she just went into the train with us. And rumors again had it, where are we going? We're going, it's a place called Belsen, you know, nobody had ever heard the word before. Belsen, and it is a recuperation place. That was a news. Well, I've learned in the meantime why it was called that. Belsen has quite a history. It started off as a prison camp, a normal prison camp, and at one time it was a camp where people were sent to recuperate. I don't know how they could recuperate in Belsen, but it has quite a history, and somebody has written a big book about it. I forget all the details. But it was supposed to be an Erholungslager. Well, it wasn't. So a few days of cattle truck went by, and we were freezing cold, and But it transpired immediately that we would stick together. The orchestra, we would stick together. We'd been through so many things already. We would keep together. And we tried to keep each other warm, you know, by blowing into each other's back. And we tried to sing our parts, orchestral parts. And we arrived in the middle of nowhere, really. That was Belsen.
What was uppermost in your mind? Relief at leaving Auschwitz?
Tremendous relief of leaving Auschwitz. Nobody could imagine that you could physically go away from the crematoria and the gas chambers. Nothing can be worse than sitting in front of, you know, the means with which you're going to be killed. So to go, I mean, we were really quite happy. Yeah, little did we know what was coming, but anything was, we thought, better than gas chamber. So we arrived in Belsen, and we walked for very many miles, probably it was, seemed endless, through the Lüneburg Heath, and arrived at the camp. And we heard a lot of shooting going on because there was an army barracks there, German army, with a shooting range. So we kept hearing this shooting. And we thought, oh, well, they're going to shoot us just for a change, you know. Because everything was so crazy. If you even think that in 1944, when the war was going as badly as it was going, the Germans would liberate rolling stock in order to bring Jews from A to B. Would have been much simpler to stick us in the gas chamber. They needed this rolling stock. Well, anyway, don't look for logic when it came to their murder machine. So we were about 3,000 people arriving there in Belsen, and Belsen had no room for us. There were no barracks. So we stood for a while in front of the camp and looked into it. And my sister said, we saw somebody with a capo band. You know, a capo was also a very good position to have. You were sort of in command of other people. And the capos didn't always behave as they should have behaved. And there was a capo, somebody with a capo band, bending into a soup vat and scraping it out. And my sister said, if a capo needs to do that, it must be very bad here. By God, she was right. Anyway, we arrived. They didn't shoot us on the way. And we arrived at the camp. And we had nowhere to be. So we were all herded into enormous tents, like a circus tent. And I remember that, you know, being quite a vintage prisoner by now, one thing is important, is that people should have somewhere to walk to the latrines. Very basic necessity. And a friend of mine, we tried to make people lie down so that would be a gangway. Forget it. I mean, we were just falling down on the floor and it was chaos.
You'd made friends in Auschwitz?
Oh, yes. I mean, yeah. we orchestra, we stuck together. We were a group, inseparable, all the way from then onwards.
Do you think that also?
Absolutely. Absolutely, yes. You see, what happened in the camp is that people formed families, camp families. You'd lost your own family, you make families. People adopted younger people. You know, it gave you some sense of importance. You try and look after somebody else. I mean, it sounds ridiculous, but we were definitely a group sticking together. That was obvious, without any discussion. That was what was going to be. And yeah, it helped. I mean, we took care of each other in a way, or we bullied each other because, you know, Belsen was so ill-equipped and so basic. And the temptation to just let yourself go is, and there was no orchestra there, is tremendous. And we bullied each other to wash whilst there was still water, which later it wasn't, you know, wash and strip and on the outside, you know, it was cold. It was much easier not to do it. It's very important to do it. And on your own, you probably wouldn't have done it. But if you got somebody else now, you haven't washed properly, you know, this is very important. So, we were lying in these tents on the bare soil. I mean, it was unbelievable. Winter, Lüneburg Heath. Then came a terrible, terrible storm, and the tents collapsed on top of us. So there we were with these enormous tents on top of, the situation was indescribable. So we tried to get out from under the tent somehow, which we managed, and I will never forget, we stood then for the rest of the night in the pouring rain in the winter, undernourished, not in the best of health, and he didn't even catch cold. I mean, what the human body can actually endure is quite unbelievable. And by next morning, we were all put into a shoe bunker. There was one barrack full of shoes. There wasn't really room for people, but because it was full of shoes. But somehow we heard it in there, and we were very grateful to just have a roof over our heads. And I remember sitting next to a Hungarian lady there for a couple of days, and I thought, I'll try and learn Hungarian whilst I'm sitting here, really quite crazy, which I didn't manage. But eventually they had barracks for us. Don't ask me why there were suddenly barracks for us. I have a suspicion because there's a huge Russian cemetery there. They may well have done away with the Russians to me. Don't ask me, I can't answer it, but suddenly there were barracks. And then started the Belsen life where things got worse and worse, and the death marches starting, and all the other camps that were not liberated but evacuated started arriving in Belsen. Belsen became an inferno. I mean, thousands and thousands of people came into Belsen. In state, you know, half dead people dragged themselves in there on these death marches. And at one time we got some work to do. We made plaits out of cellophane. Long, long plaits. And I can only imagine that was some sort of rope. So we worked for a bit there, and then we didn't work, and then, you know, it was suddenly was no food and there was no water, and you perished in Belsen, you perished. Typhoid, no facility, nothing. And then the body started mounting up, and there was no way to deal with the bodies. You know, Auschwitz had this fantastic facility there. But Belsen, no, there was nothing. So we lived among heaps of bodies.
And what happened if somebody died in your barracks then?
Chuck them out. I remember the first body. You see, at first Belsen wasn't as terrible as it was in the end. I mean, there was no room for us, but there were no dead bodies lying around. And I remember that there was in the block where I was dwelling, I can only say, a news went around there, somebody is dead here, so what do we do with that? What do you do with a dead person? And I thought, we have to get that dead person out of here. And I volunteered to do it. I just thought, I'll just do it. I mean, I'd never touched a dead body before. I've seen dead bodies, but not the... So somebody else came, and we just put that body out, one body. Well, it didn't take long before that was multiplied by thousands. And there's no way to get rid of them. And by that time, it got warmer. So, you know, you had the stench of the bodies just, just lying there and decomposing. You know, you can't really describe it. It was, I mean, pictures of Belsen after liberation. But, you know, it was meaningless to us, a dead body by that time. Totally meaningless. Heaps of them there, heaps of them there. And then the SS, no food and nothing. So it was a matter of this, obviously, it's not going to last very long. And then by that time it was April, and then came the big miracle that we heard a lot of rumbling noises outside the camp.
Were the Germans still there by this time?
Less and less Germans were visible. But by that time we knew that they quite like to blow up camps before they get discovered. So we weren't sure whether that meant that they dynamited the camp, because that also happened. But sure enough, it was a Sunday, and we heard these noises, and people said, you know, that might be tanks, British tanks. Well, whose tanks? You know, it could be tanks, but whose tanks? How do you know? But at 5 o'clock, the first tank, or whatever, I think it was a jeep, came into the camp. And that was it.
And we've just come to the end of the third tape there. Anita Lasker-Wallfisch. It's April 1945, and you're in the camp at Bergen-Belsen. Where were you when, the noises started and people started saying, it's tanks?
I must admit that my memory is a little bit vague there, but I have a report of my sister who wrote what she did on that day. My sister tried to get some water, and she knew there was still a water tap somewhere just outside the compound, and there was quite a harmless SS man standing there. And she writes in this report that he didn't stop her. She went with a bucket outside, tried to fill it with water, came back into the camp, and everybody was so thirsty that they just jumped on her, tried to get the water, and what happened that the water spilled and nobody had any water. And that she came then and took me out into the open air. Apparently I wasn't well. I suppose it's the understatement of the century. And we sat outside with our backs to a barrack surrounded by bodies and heard this noise. And suddenly we heard an announcement. You are liberated. This is the British Army. You are liberated. But please keep calm and whatever. The announcement was. And I always have to, people have an imagination that people get liberated after such a terrible time, that they jump with joy, but nobody jumped with joy. We were all very silent, partly through lack of strength and lack of actually believing what was happening. It was just too enormous to be assimilated. And then came the period which I can only understand also again in retrospect. So we were liberated. So these poor soldiers suddenly, they didn't know what they're going to find on the way. They knew the war was still on, one mustn't forget. They knew there was a prison camp there. Well, they had their own idea of what a prison camp is like. They have never seen anything like it. And they were suddenly confronted with this enormous problem of the bodies, the sick people, and the zombies that we were. And of course, the first thing was to get rid of the bodies, which then the Germans that they managed to catch in the surroundings had to do themselves. I've got a lovely picture of that.
The British Army brought Germans back.
Yeah, some of them. For instance, Karma, the camp commander, was caught there. And there were quite a number who were still there, but the majority had gone. Also, I learned after reading reports is that apparently the British Army tried to come to some arrangement with this prison camp before they knew what it was, and said, if you hand over this camp, we will let you go. But of course, and they probably thought this was going to happen, but when they saw what was happening, of course they don't let anybody go. So they were all arrested and then had to clear up the camp. And it must have been a tremendous problem for the British Army to deal with the likes of us. Who are we anyway? People without anything. Most of them half dead. So a big sorting out began into nationalities. I suppose the idea was to repatriate people, which is all very well for people who want to be repatriated. It was not a major problem for French, Dutch, Belgians to go home. They also were received by, because they were occupied countries. But if you happen to be German like me, the last thing I want to do is go home. There is no such place as home. And it is just out of the question. So we became what is called displaced persons.
What happened to you, though, in those few days after the British army arrived? Do you remember?
I tell you what was then a big problem is that they were so shocked, the soldiers. All they could think of is to give us food, and that was also a terrible mistake, because people who haven't eaten can't deal with food. So a lot of people died just, can you imagine a tin of corned beef or something like that? I don't know how we escaped this disaster somehow, but we were given food. That was the first thing, given food, and they tried to reinstall the water, and just the most basic things were repaired.
Were you kept in the camp itself?
Oh, yes. I mean, there's no question. I mean, we are not allowed to go. Actually, one of the announcements was you're not allowed to leave the camp because of the typhus. We got typhus in the camp. We knew very well there was typhus in the camp. But, where would we have gone anyway? Belsen is in the middle of nowhere, really, on the Lüneburg Heath. Where does one go? There's nowhere to go. So there's no question of leaving the camp. I mean, they were afraid that we would all, run away, but I mean, no way.
Did you understand English at this point?
No, I didn't. But my sister, who went to school in Florence and to study for her matric there, has a lot of languages. And she was immediately, they looked desperately for people who could interpret. So very soon she was an interpreter for the British Army. And it didn't take too long where she said, look, they're looking for people to help here. Why don't you become an interpreter? I said, well, I don't happen to speak English. It's just, it doesn't matter. You become an interpreter anyway. So I think I must be the first interpreter ever who had an interpreter's band without actually being able to speak the language that she was supposed to interpret. But I started my life as an interpreter in an office of the British Army, typing. I can't type either, but anyhow, with two fingers, and I was copying army reports, and it took no time for me to actually understand more. I kept hearing English spoken, it didn't take too long to get the hang of the English language. And so I was working for the British Army as an interpreter, whilst my friends who were French, Belgium, eventually went home. And we managed to somehow come in contact with what was left of my family through one of the search broadcasts that were made after the war. What happened that a BBC van came into the camp, and somebody called me and said, look, here's a BBC van and he takes messages. So I went there, and it was my first experience of talking to a microphone. I've got the transcript of it, which is really so confused, but German, I speak German, very, very good German, much better than I can do now, looking for my sister. I said, here's, spricht Anita Lasker, and so on. And my sister actually didn't hear it, but a friend of hers heard it, and it was always repeated. They kept repeating these things, and this is how I came in contact again with...
This was your eldest sister?
My eldest sister was in England. And then started a terrible period of trying to go somewhere and realizing that it is not a good situation to be a displaced person without any papers and without anything, even talk about money.
While you were interpreting for the British Army, did they ask you questions about where you'd been and what you'd seen and what you went through?
Yes, I mean, we became very friendly with some of the people that we worked with. I can't remember too much whether we told them great details. But once you've seen a camp like Belsen, you already understood what had been going on. I mean, we had some very, very good friends there who really did everything to help us, also to get us clothes. And also there wasn't a postal service then, you mustn't forget. You couldn't just write a letter. So we used the army addresses, whoever was stationed in Belsen, that was a Corporal Smith, used his address. Then I would write to my sister, Corporal Smith has now been to go somewhere else. Could you use now Captain Horwell or whatever? You see, we always used army addresses. But it was a very desperate search for actually being allowed to go somewhere. And one came to realize that the world was not a perfect place, even after everything was finished, that nobody was going crazy to have you.
Where were you when the war ended?
Well, when the war ended, we were in Belsen, but Belsen was burned down eventually. On the 21st of May, the last barrack was burned. And what happened to the people who were able to be transferred? We were transferred into that very army barracks that the shooting came from. That became Belsen Displaced Persons Camp and stayed Belsen Displaced Persons Camp for years and years and years. I've been back there and I saw graves of people who died in 53, 8 years after liberation, which is a terrible indictment to the world. So Belsen proper, the camp as I knew it, was razed to the ground with a big ceremony at the end. The last barrack, the picture of Hitler and a swastika, and they brought flamethrowers, I've got pictures of that, and burned it down. By that time I was already an interpreter, and then we were quite a few of us. We were transferred also then to the other camp, which is about 3 kilometers away. And we were very lucky because we had a little interpreter's house, a sort of must have been a garden hut. It no longer exists. I looked for it when I went back there. So we had our private accommodation and did not have to go into these enormous barracks. You know, it was a lot better than what was before. But the people who had to stay there and had nowhere to go, it was not all that pleasant.
But what was it for you to hear that the war was over at last?
Oh, fantastic. I mean, it was unbelievable, unbelievable. The war was over and, well, it was very difficult to actually really take on board the whole implication that you'd actually survived this. I mean, it was, you know, why? How? And both of us, my sister and I mean, it was tremendous. And then, I mean, I've got the letters that I wrote to my sister because, you know, irony of fate, the only person of my family who emigrated died in childbirth, having her second child. So after her death, my sister's death, who by then was in Israel, all the letters that my parents and my sister and I had written to her in 39, 40, and then during the war via Switzerland, etc., and 45 after liberation, are in my possession. So a lot of things that I had forgotten in a way had come back again through the letters. And they are really quite a document, because also the then more and more desperate letters after liberation, that we can't go anywhere, nobody wants us. I have all the refusals from the Home Office and etc. It was very difficult, but it took about a year, and got here in March 46.
When did you hear what had happened to your parents? When did you find out?
Well, knowing what was going on, I did not exactly entertain any hopes that I would ever see my parents again. But what actually did happen to them, I found out when I came to England and went to the Biener Library, which is a institute invented by Dr. Wiener. It's nothing to do with Vienna. It's a documentation place of the persecution of the Jews. It's situated in London. I went there, and they have a lot of information. And I knew where my parents had gone, to Izbica near Lublin, and I found out what the method of murdering people was there. It was a famous place where they had to dig their own graves and be shot into these graves. That's what happened in that area. Yeah.
After the war, were you ever asked to be a witness at all?
Yes, when I was I think it was September, when they created a trial for the Belsen criminals, the Lüneburg trial, and I was asked to be a witness there. And the experience was quite salutary. So by that time, I spoke enough English to not have an interpreter. And I have the letters that I wrote about this this trial. And one of the letters, I said, it's the first time that I see how impossible it is for the outside world to understand what has been going on here. Because it was a proper trial, British justice, innocent till proven guilty. And I was exposed to the most ridiculous questions. I have a transcript of this trial in my book, which really, I think, tells you enough. I would be asked questions like, did you ever see anybody kill anybody? And I'd say yes. And I'd be asked, what day was it? And I'd say, I don't know. What time was it? Was it a stick? Was it a stone? Was it... Oh, my God. I couldn't answer these questions because, A, I didn't have a watch, B, I couldn't care less whether it was, what date it was. And the moment you then, because you're under oath, and I was a very good girl, I wasn't going to invent anything, you immediately feel like a liar. So the whole trial seemed a total and utter farce to me because you cannot apply British justice, which is a very commendable thing, to something that is so outside anything that's ever been. You know, it's admittedly most of the people were sentenced to death, but the whole system suddenly made me realize this is stuff that will never really be understood unless you've been in it.
Do you think then it was right for those trials to go ahead?
Yes, what else can you do? I mean, the alternative is lynching. And no, I think it was right what happened. It just seemed slightly, that we couldn't really understand it. But I mean, what can you do, really? And all the denazification and all this, it was a good attempt. It didn't really work, because who did they know who the Nazis were? Suddenly there wasn't a single Nazi in the whole of Germany anyway. And the denazification, of course, overlooked many, many people who should have been denazified, because when normality, as it were, was reinstalled, one needed people in certain places. And if you were told that the judge in this court was a dreadful man, a bad man, a Nazi, yeah, but we need somebody there. There is nobody else. And this is how the thing got perpetuated, that a lot of people were left in places where they shouldn't have been because there was no other way to deal with it.
The trial that you were involved in, you said a lot of the people were sentenced to death.
Yeah.
But was that any kind of resolution or satisfaction for
No,
you?
Not to me. It was never a satisfaction. It was never a satisfaction to me. No, it's difficult to... I mean, that was obvious. That was the natural thing that it would go that way. You know, if you take every case separately and analyze what made these people do what they were doing, perhaps nowadays you could find explanations or excuses, but it doesn't work. I mean, these people couldn't possibly not have been sentenced to death. Although they themselves thought it was unjust. They only did their duty, you know. In Germany, everybody always did their duty. I did what I was told to do. And there are certain things which are misunderstood nowadays, like, for instance, the Einsatztruppen, you know, the people who did this murdering in Ukraine, etc.
I mean, special
like
troops.
My parents, special troops. The excuse was always, if I didn't do it, I would be sent to the Russian front. And this is not true. There have been people who refused to do this mass murdering and were not sent to the Russian front. So the excuse that you risk your own life if you refuse to do what you were told is a very feeble excuse.
Were you eventually allowed to come to England after the war?
Yes, eventually. Eventually, the Home Office he gave us permission. I mean, even that was complicated. But, you know, again, in retrospect, okay, England won the war, but I can understand that the refugee problem was perhaps not first on the agenda, although it would have been nice if it had been. And the ludicrous thing is when I finally got to England and I had to report at the Home Office, I got alien registration, enemy alien. Because I'm German, so a German is an enemy. You know, the red tape and the stupidity of people who sit and dispense the tape is limitless. So I didn't even understand what enemy alien means. And when my cousin saw it, with whom I lived there, he went straight back to the Home Office and said, "You've got to be out of your mind. Enemy alien." So they scrapped that with apologies. But for a bit, I was an enemy alien.
Did you talk about things here with your sister?
No, you see, that was another thing which very often, now that I've written a book and we are 60 years on and all that sort of thing, people always ask, did you talk about it? What was very upsetting for us that nobody asked any questions. We did not talk about it, which we found very... very disappointing, because we thought that with what we have seen and gone through, we will change the world. And nothing like that will ever happen again, etc. We were full of great ideas. Instead of that, we fell into a hole of silence, and I'm not the only one who will tell you that. Questions were not asked, and if I now think back, had I been asked any questions, like for instance, tell me what was it like in Auschwitz, I'm not sure I could have answered it, actually. It is, in fact, not a topic for conversation, concentration camps. Now, I suppose it's taken a natural development. I think it needed half a century for people to address this, because one is just time-wise far enough removed, and it's possible to ask questions now. And also, you know, people have this strange idea, if you ask somebody like me a question about a concentration camp, you're afraid that I might faint, you know, suddenly remember what it was like in a concentration camp. I come across this quite often now that I talk to schools, etc. The thing is, I don't need you to ask me a question, what was this like in a concentration camp, to remember that I was in a concentration camp. You know, I don't know who, I think it was Elie Wiesel who said, whoever has been in Auschwitz never comes, can never leave it, and who's never been in Auschwitz will never enter it. And I think there is a lot of truth. And people ask me, has it changed you as a person? I wouldn't know what sort of a person I would have been if I hadn't been in a concentration camp. But I think whoever has been in a concentration camp, I think it has stamped you in some way, you know. You don't have to be reminded by being asked a question about it.
But are there ever times when you forget?
Yeah, sure. I mean, when I finally came to England, I didn't want anything to do with concentration camps, really. I was still young, very old for what I wanted to do, because you don't start studying music at the age of 20. You finished studying music. So I was totally one-track minded to catch up 8 years that I've been stolen off me, and I wanted to be just normal, a normal person. You don't think 24 hours a day of concentration camp. No, I was a normal person, tried to be madly normal and bring up my children normal, you know. In fact, looking back, it wasn't as normal as I thought it was, but when we tried, you know, tried to be normal.
How did you make a living in England?
With difficulties at first, because first of all, I didn't have a working permit, and you can't have a working permit unless you are a member of the union, but you can't become a member of the union if you haven't got a working permit, so we're again catch 22. But I was asked that question actually just a few days ago when I was doing a talk. Was it difficult for you to settle down in England? And I said, no, it was very easy, because I had enormous help here, enormous help from all sides. I very quickly even got jobs as a cellist from people who knew that I wasn't in the union and who knew that I didn't have a working permit. And I would never be asked to do a job in a theater, for instance, where sometimes people can check up union cards. I've never seen it happen, but it's possible. And it is not I who would get into trouble. It's the union members that get into trouble. But I had a sense of being protected, or by my colleagues later. Really, I mean, I did get work. I mean, not a lot, you know, here and there, but everything helped. Whether I was a union member or not, you know, and eventually I became a union member, got a working permit, but it took 5 years. But I was working all the same, so somebody, they all knew that, you know, so I had really, I'm very, very grateful that I came to this country. And, you know, I have a great affection for it because I had a lot of help and support here.
Were you married here?
Yes, I got married here to a boy from my school, admittedly. I went right back to my childhood again.
Did you meet him again in London?
No, I met him in Paris. He was also sort of itinerant. He was studying. And he left in time. He left Germany in time. He was 13. He went to Palestine. And as soon as the war was over, he went to Switzerland to take part in a competition, which he didn't win, but he won a scholarship. And he was then studying in Paris. And when, for the first time, I went on holidays after I came to England, I said to a colleague of mine, I'm going to Paris, because I've never seen Paris, you know, I must see Paris. And he said, you know, there's somebody there who you might know, Peter Wallfisch. I said, of course I know Peter Wallfisch. So we met there. And that was that.
Was the difference in your experience ever between you, as it were, because of what you'd gone through? But he had left as a child. He didn't go through it.
You mean, was it an impediment? No, no. Because he suffered in his own way, you know, to be transplanted suddenly from a normal life to Palestine for these children also was very difficult. They didn't know the language, and of course he hasn't suffered in the way that I have. But no, I don't think in terms of measuring people's suffering. You know.
And you went on as a musician in Britain?
Yes, oh yes, absolutely.
And how many children have you got?
Two. And one of them is a musician, and he's got three children, and two of them threatening to be musicians. And so it goes on.
Have you ever been back to Germany?
Yes, I have been back. Strangely enough, because I absolutely swore never ever to put my foot on German soil again. But by some funny sort of constellation, you know, the orchestra I play in travels a tremendous amount, and they've gone to Germany 100 times, but Anita doesn't go to Germany, so okay, somebody else goes, that's fine. And we always get lists, you know, what we're doing the next month, etc. And I see on one of the lists, Soltau and Celle, and these are places very near Belsen. So I rang up the office and I said, sit tight, I'm coming on this trip, because I suddenly thought I need to see what's become of Belsen. So I went back for the first time, much to the fear of my colleagues, who they all thought I was going to shoot everybody on site. But this is admittedly was 45 years after I swore never to go again. And it was very fortuitous, the whole thing. I went to see the camp and the museum, and some colleagues came along. The museum was extremely disappointing, just a small room, nothing. And it's quite a long story in itself, but I met the director of the museum. And from that day onwards, I'm in contact with the museum. I've been able to contribute a lot there. Now it's a very big museum. It's all been rebuilt. And altogether, it has produced only positive things that I've gone back. Also for myself, in a way, because I found it is possible for me to talk to a German without cringing, providing he's the right age, and I don't have to ask any question. The first German that I met in Germany was a man of 45, born in 1945. So he didn't have to tell me that he wasn't a Nazi. And I now, since my book is out in Germany, I get invited a lot to go to Germany, and I speak to almost a second generation after. And I think it is very important to do that, that we don't actually, I mean, bridges have to be built. One has to speak to each other again, or it will end badly again. So it was a good thing that I went back. I mean, I didn't ask for anything that's happened since then. It seemed to be natural outcome of my first time to go back to Germany. I mean, I've done better going back than staying away.
We've just come very nearly to the end of the interview mm-hmm. now. Is there anything you would like to say that you haven't said, you feel?
You know, there's so much one can still say. I think it's important that people identify with people when we talk about the Holocaust, because I always feel this idea of 6 million dead people is totally futile. Nobody can, there's no concept of that. But the generation that come after us, if they talk about the Holocaust and just think of 6 million people, it becomes a dead territory. And I think these interviews are important for the people to see that we were actually people and totally normal people, and nothing wrong with us, coming from totally normal families, being reduced to what we were reduced to, which led to the to this unprecedented mass murder that the Holocaust is, which in a way it cannot be compared with all the other genocides that have taken place. And I think that is also important, because genocides get lumped together. You know, we got Yugoslavia, we got the Tutsis, we got the American Indians, whatever. You know, you can, there's no end of unbelievably terrible genocides. But the important thing, I think, is to remember that the Holocaust was totally imaginary. It wasn't territorial. It was an ideological total madness to drag people from all over the world, all over Europe, in order to kill them. And there was no question of that they could defend themselves. You know, it wasn't a fair war. I mean, you know, you know what I'm talking about. It is unique in the concept, this, and the marvelous way in which it was designed and premeditated and executed. That's all I can say.
Anita Lasker-Wallfisch, thanks very much indeed. The interview with Anita Lasker-Wallfisch. Anita, could you tell me whose pictures we're seeing now?
These are photographs of my parents, Alphonse Lasker and Edith Lasker.
And what was your mother's maiden name?
Hamburger.
And where was she from?
She was born in Gliwice. It's Gliwice now, it's all Polish now.
And your father, where was he born?
He was born in Kempen, which is also Polish now.
Do you know, Do you know where these were taken, or what time they would have been taken?
My father, I think, was about 50 years old then. So he was born in 1886. So you work that out. He was about 50, I think.
And your mother?
My mother, I think, must have been a little bit before that. I can't really remember.
Anita, tell me about this picture.
Well, this is a picture of my sister Renate after she came to England and worked for the BBC.
And what year would this have been taken, do you think?
I think 48, possibly. 1948.
And where was it taken?
Well, it was at Bush House, I think, because it was working at Bush House.
In London?
Yeah.
Anita, tell me about this picture.
This is a picture of my husband, Peter Wallfisch. He was a pianist. He died at the age of 69, 5 years ago. And we went to school together in Breslau.
And this picture was taken here in London?
Yes, it is a publicity picture for one of his concerts.
Anita, who's this in this picture here?
This is my son, Raphael Wallfisch. As you can see, he's a cellist as well. And it's a publicity photograph.
And where was Raphael born?
In London.
And what year?
1953.
And who's in this shot, Anita?
This is my daughter, Maya. She was born in 1958, also in London, and she is a counselor by profession. This is a picture of my eldest grandson, Benjamin, and he's at university now, studying music. He's very gifted. He's a composer, pianist, conductor, you name it.
And when was Benjamin born?
Well, now you're asking me. He's 19 now. You work that out.
89. No, that can't be right. 79. 1979, 19 years ago.
79, yes. This is my second grandson, Simon Wallfisch, also threatening to become a cellist. He was born in 1982, also in London. He's still at school now. And this is my granddaughter, Joanna Wallfisch. She is 13 now, still goes to school, wondering whether she'd be an actress or a musician. I think it'll probably be actress in the end. This is my youngest grandson. He's 3 and a half now. He's my daughter's son, and his name is Abraham Peter Jacobs, also known as AB. And that's me playing the cello some 40 years ago.
Which orchestra are you playing with there?
English Chamber Orchestra.
I'm sorry.
That's me, Anita Lasker-Wallfisch, and I'm playing with the English Chamber Orchestra. This picture was taken at the BBC some 40 years ago.